host of Sequel Jurassic Park one at a time. I'm Brad.
I'm Dave.
And today we're back to discuss Minute 101 of The Lost World.
Welcome to Jurassic Park 101.
Well, that's what we've tried to achieve over the thing, is sort of your 101, The Lost World. Tried to tell you everything about the film, both on screen and off screen, so...
Mm-hmm.
They're headed in a port, but I can't raise them.
Try again.
Skipper SS Venture, this is NGen Harbormaster. Do you copy? Over. Skipper SS Venture, you are approaching the breakwater at flank speed. Reduce at once. Over.
All right, due to a couple of time restraints, we're going to get straight into the minutes this week. We're not going to talk about news until next week, but shortest episodes yet. Dave, ready to get into 101?
Sure.
As we're in the minute 100 of Lost World, the SS Venture had appeared through the fog, as Ian and Sarah had turned and ran, along with the rest of the crowd. As we open on minute 101, the crowd continues to run towards the front gate of the NGen Waterfront Complex. At the 4-second mark, the ship impacts the dock, obliterating the office, sending timber and debris flying in all directions. At the 10-second mark, the ship continues to cut its way through the dock, tipping a limo, as scared VIPs run. At the 15-second mark, after the bow of the ship knocks over the capture cage intended for the Tyrannosaur, it stops. Ian and Sarah get up and start to follow Ludlow towards the ship. At the 38-second mark, Ludlow and a security guard emerge on the deck of the ship, looking around for the crew. The guard and Ludlow quickly make their way towards the ship's bridge and are disgusted by the sight they see there. Ludlow asks, "Where's the crew?" And the guard replies, "All over the place." And this ends minute 101 of The Lost World. As we opened last week, we've seen SS Venture approaching the dock very quickly, and Sarah turned to run. And as I said in that minute, it's just weird to see a couple of men in suits here look at them as they're starting to run away and just looking at them weirdly, like, why are you running? But as we move through the crowd, there's some workers at the back of the main crowd that are sort of turning and running as well, because they were watching and seeing the ship approach. But we did see in that last minute, they were all just staring out the ocean as the sound was getting louder, so they all should have known what was coming and reacted at the same time. But
yeah, exactly.
We cut to a lowdown shot looking through the truck and trailer and with the cage on the back that's parked on the dock as the ship impacts, sort of... It's a little bit of a cheat showing the model hitting, or not showing the model hitting clearly, sort of hindered behind the truck. As we said previous minutes, this is all miniatures. We've got some photos we can post up in the group.
Yep.
For the episode two of just how they done it. And yeah, the office building just explodes like matchsticks. And then we cut higher up as the ship continues. We cut higher up as the ship continues and... through the office and further ahead, we did see before Ludlow escaped that it was a good 8 to 10 people inside that building. We'd never seen anyone come out after Ludlow.
Yeah, exactly.
And it's sort of weird here. We'll get a bit of a G.I. Joe theme later on where we see everyone sort of start to emerge from debris and that. It's like, okay, everyone survived, but I don't think anyone in that building did. Because we see...
And I think it's interesting how on the miniature, as the miniature pulls up, you can actually see a tiny speck of wood. But it is a pretty good-sized miniature. I mean, the whole ship itself is probably about 8 or 9 feet long.
Yeah, it's a massive miniature. And I've seen photos, I don't know if it's the actual miniature afterwards, but it ended up in the Amity set area from Universal, didn't it? Where the Jaws stuff is. It was in that little lagoon there with the... Oh, I can't remember the name of the boat in Jaws now, but
the Orca?
Yeah, the Orca, that's the one, yeah. But it was with that at Universal for a long time before, I'm guessing it just, as props do, got into disrepair, it probably sunk, and they probably had to retrieve it, and it got pulled apart, probably, but...
Yeah, unfortunately. Yeah. I don't think it's made, it's probably just made of plastic or something.
Well, yeah, it's sort of... how it has to break through the timber, whether that's balsa wood or...
Mm-hmm.
Because it's got to look like it's going for a real structure, so...
Yeah, it does.
Especially when we get that high up shot in one of the side shots here where we see VIPs fleeing and a limo gets overturned. It's sort of interacting, or it's probably just CG, but it's interacting with the miniature.
It is. And speaking of which, I do like how when you get this close-up shot of the bow as it's finally coming to a stop, you can see small planks of wood kind of just that had gotten tossed up onto the front of the bow. You can see it through the front hole there. Yeah. I'm not really sure what those would be called, not porthole, but whatever. Yeah, it does add like a nice touch of realism because it's this wonderful miniature that blends seamlessly in with the real ship that was called the American Salvador. Yep. I mentioned that early in one of the earlier minutes, but I just refresh you.
Yeah, because it's from memory, the only other miniature work they'd done in the franchise was the plane crash in Jurassic Park 3.
Well, the Jurassic Park San Diego, the overhead shot of the Malcolm's car entering the place was also a miniature. We'll talk about that in that minute. We have photos of that.
Well, that's the thing. We call them a miniature when like even that thing was big. I remember a guy standing beside it working on it. It's up to his chest.
Yeah, it reminds me of the miniatures that Peter Jackson used on Lord of the Rings, and some of those were how do you call them miniatures when they're bigger than you are?
But then that's the other thing too, like they're designed and built to be cheaper than either doing a CG layout or whatever else, but just some of the work that went into some of those sets, like Isengard and that, like, you gotta wonder.
The Tower of Barad-dûr was massive. It was, I want to say, like, 9 feet tall, and it was just that, Peter Jackson would go and take the camera and just close up, just slowly, like, for that one shot, I think, from Fellowship of the Ring, where we get the camera pan up all the way up to the CGI Eye of Sauron. It was just the camera slowly going up the, like it was like a 9 or 10 foot miniature, and then they just sped up the film.
Yeah.
Make it look like the tower was speeding up to the great Eye of Sauron. Yeah. But Minas Tirith too, I mean, that was massive. It was, I want to say, like 12 feet across.
Yeah.
It's huge.
Yeah. And I'm pretty sure they're all kept. That he's got them in his museum bunker, man cave, whatever you want to call it, down there.
He keeps up. Actually, he has a couple Jurassic Park items in his collection. I've seen a gallery of his collection, and it's just beautiful history worth of. Everything of like all kinds of movie memorabilia, and I'm glad that it's in his hands because I know that Peter Jackson would just appreciate that more than some random guy who would be like, yeah, I got a piece of Jurassic Park history. Want to see?
It's locked behind his door.
Yeah, no, it's like something that entertains other businessmen and just something he's not really even a fan of. It's just something he could afford to buy or like.
Well, it's more like a trophy.
Testicle. exactly.
But then that's
Have you seen the movie Ted?
Oh, not for a while.
Oh, well, you know where Mark Wahlberg goes into his girlfriend's boss's house, and he's got that memorabilia there that he really doesn't even care for. I imagine half these props I end up with. Mm. You know, just rich jerks who have no passion for what they're actually collecting.
Yeah.
They do it because they can afford it.
Yeah, and that's the thing. Sort of the miniatures were pioneered back with Star Wars and the 70s with all those sort of space films and that, where they used all the miniatures. And it was sort of sad in, I think it was 99 with Starship Troopers, that was the last time they used miniatures, or full-size miniatures on set until Lord of the Rings come around and sort of brought it back in, but it still hasn't been a massively used technique for doing filming, unfortunately.
Remember, filming is nothing more than grown adults playing with toys.
Yeah.
And That's what I drew my parents when I say I'm going off to the woods with a pack full of dinosaur toys and a digital camera, and I just tell them, and they say, have fun playing with the toys. I say, it's not toys, it's doing dioramas. Gosh. It's remember, it's not playing if a camera's involved. Yeah. That's what I tell them.
Like, one of my favourite uses of it would be James Cameron's Aliens. Just all the ships in that are all miniatures.
Yeah.
Even the even the first Alien, the ship that touches down on LV-426. Yeah. That whole miniature, I remember seeing that turned up somewhere. It was in someone's driveway. It was like the size of a car with a tarp over it, and someone. Mm-hmm. I don't know if it was ILM or someone got their hands on it at an auction, or someone brought it and then they've approached them and said, here, can you restore this, and got it back to its near original state. But
I remember that the some of the miniatures for Independence Day were massive. Like the mothership, but the saucer ships, the ones that blew up the cities, were like 10 feet across, if not bigger, and they filmed it in a swimming pool with clouds of food coloring imitating the storms.
Well, that's, and you sort of look at any air quotes disaster porn now where cities are being destroyed and it's all CG and all that, but sort of going back to that original Independence Day, they had just large sections of city miniatures on their side up against a wall and lit the fire at the bottom and just had the fire rolling up through and through the buildings to make it look like those ships had just fired their weapons. So
yeah, they literally blew up like a giant version of a giant miniature of the White House.
And even that was one take. They had one chance to film that right. And luckily,
and they did it beautifully.
Because even that, you have a miniature that large and have to have it explode explode the way you want to, and not just look like there's a firecracker inside it. That would have been a very stressful day on set. But
Aliens was like that as well, because in the first movie when the chestbuster came out, that was all the first shot, because Ridley Scott got all real reactions. None of the cast knew what the hell was going to come out of this guy.
That was a great story to hear.
I know, isn't it? And then, of course, the second happened with James Cameron when he torched the chestburster with the flamethrower. They had one shot at it. And so he just created that one rod puppet and burned it one time.
Oh, hope for the best. But back to the minute at hand, after that little trip down memory lane, the bow of the ship impacts... it's worth it. The bow of the ship impacts that trailer and cage we've seen earlier, and sort of overturns it and pushes it to the side and rolls the truck onto its side as well as it comes to a stop, and we get pipes and debris banging and clanging as stuff landing back on the ground, and a bit of a shaky cam here with just Sarah and crew starting to sit up as the camera's just shaking weirdly.
I think it's supposed to be imitating the ship's motors stalling out as they vibrate against the dock, you know?
Well, yeah, you gotta think, okay, is it ran aground here, or is it just impacted enough and slowed itself down to stop? Or is the back of the ship in the mud and the propellers are fouled up, and that's sort of stalled the engines out? But it's probably a good thing it did stop here and it was only doing 26 miles and not 27 or 28, because if it come another... a couple of meters, like, everyone's getting up, they're only meters from that rolled over cage. Very close, they didn't get very far in the time it took to escape. But that's the miniature done, and we'll get some photos up so you can have a look at how they done that. And we've talked at end about it, so I won't go on any further about that. Ludlow's the first to stand and starts running back towards the ship, and, the security guard sort of meets him on that little bridge again and asks him if he's okay. And he's like, I don't know, how do I look? Which, I think he doesn't...
It's such a Ludlow thing, he'd say, you know? I don't know, how's my hair? My hair okay?
Yep. Like, you see me with my two arms, don't you? Well, I'm fine. But we also we see other security guards on site, sort of helping, asking if people are okay and helping people to their feet, with VIPs and that. And we see one helping someone out of that overturned limo. And as I said earlier, it's just, it's like G.I. Joe, where, oh yeah, there's always a parachute when someone gets thrown out of a plane, or it just sort of just showing that everyone's okay when, of course, there's a good 8 or 9 people dead from that office. But yeah. Ed and Sarah sort of get up and they start running through the debris as well, as the security guy and Ludlow begin to climb up that section of roof that's leaning on the side of the Venture. And the guard and Ludlow step up onto the ship with a worried look on their faces. Now, I don't know where to go with this. I just found interesting these security guards have got badges on, like police badges on their chest. Is that a common security guard thing over there?
In America, yeah, it is.
So
it's very common, especially for like private security forces and even private police forces to be almost paramilitary in nature.
No, that makes sense. That's all right, because over here, most security guards, and I'll probably get in trouble for this, so just...
America loves its paramilitary.
Oh, yeah.
And its military, and its militias, and its gun nuts. Yep. But we won't get into that.
No.
that's
exactly right. Yeah, they step up on the ship, and we get a wider cut back as they sort of start walking onto the ship, revealing that Trenosaur cage, enclosure, structure, the whole front of it.
It looks like it's been busted, doesn't it?
Yeah, well, the whole front of it's torn open, so, and there's bits and debris laying on the ship deck.
So, yeah, I think that people think, oh, the Tyrannosaurus should shut the door behind himself when he went down there, but I honestly think that T-Rex broke out, ate a bunch of people, they tried luring it back, people tried getting into the cargo hold to get away from it. T-Rex followed them, and the guy on the bridge managed to get the thing closed before he
succumbed to his wounds or injury. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, we'll see at the end. There's still that hand on the wheel that's an issue, but maybe we can come back with Nick when we get there.
Well, a lot of people like to theorize that raptors got on there and tore them apart, and then somehow magically disappeared.
Yeah, well, we can discuss that more in the next minute, because in the, we will talk about this minute in the shooting script. we'll talk about that in a minute when we get to the shooting script, because there's a couple of things described in there that sort of lean more to something other than a Trenosaur causing damage. But
which is interesting, because David Coet, who wrote the script, said it was only ever the Tyrannosaur. The T-Rex was the only thing that was ever envisioned to be on the boat.
Yeah.
But yeah, I partially blame the end of the Jurassic Park Chaos Island video game, where we see raptors kind of lurking outside the SS Venture dock.
Ah, okay.
So I think that's partially where that comes from.
I was wondering what sort of started that, because I think as we talked earlier, there was that script, there was a like fan fiction going around for that Jurassic Park 3 raptors in the city, and sort of implying that this was all caused by that. And we have a bit of a similar situation here as what we do in Jurassic Park 3 with the parasailing attack, where people seemingly disappear, and if it was the animal that it was suggested, there would have been a lot more damage, i.e. that Trenosaur's head trying to get in and chomp someone and their hand still staying on the steering wheel of the ship. without breaking a window or anything, or even getting up onto that flybridge.
David Kep never said that it was a well-written scene.
No. No.
He only admitted he wrote it. He never said he wrote it well.
No, that's it. But it's sort of interesting, as they walk onto the deck, we get sort of the structure the Trenosaur was kept in. Sort of, we know it was airlifted onto the boat, and it was just sat here. It's weird it wasn't put in the hold, where it just seemed to stay on the dock, on the deck for the entire trip.
It is weird, because if you look behind everybody coming onto the boat in this scene, you can see the ship's crane right next to the cargo hold there.
Yep. And then I suppose, okay, so they're planning on coming into San Diego. Well, Ludlow says it's early, so I wonder how early it actually is. If it had to do manoeuvres out offshore and then slow, it would have come into the harbour or in the dock a lot slower, so maybe that would have added an hour or so to the travel time, but yes.
Well, also, ships of that size docking anywhere take some time in themselves, you know? Yeah.
No, I'm just wondering if you'd have some eager person with a camera as the ship's coming in or passing another cruise ship or something like that, where here's this Tyrannosaurus Rex in a cage on the deck in plain sight of... But again, as I said, like they've come in the cover of darkness here, so... And early in the morning, so...
Yeah, and there's, of course, not very many people out that late at night, you know? I'm sure this would have been a busy shipping lane in the middle of the day, and it would have made it even more dangerous and possibly spooked the Tyrannosaurus as they were loading him into the truck there. And can you imagine the people would... I mean, because it's San Diego, it's a tourist hub. That's the whole reason of building Jurassic Park San Diego there in the first place. So, can you imagine the number of people with disposable cameras walking around San Diego? Because that was a really big thing back then, in the 80s and the
90s. Yep.
And just snapping pictures of a live T-Rex in a cage, you know?
Yeah, well, and as you said before, for getting spooked, like, you just imagine the air traffic and that. Because I know our local SeaWorld here actually has helicopter flights that take off just as a sightseeing thing that sort of looks around the city that the park's in, and not necessarily the park, it's not that large, but if you've got helicopters coming and going and all that noise is going to presumably spook the male. But
yeah.
But we pull back here as the guard starts to run up the staircase and climbs up towards the ship's bridge, and Ludlow's following close behind, and the guard gets to the bridge and looks in through the door and starts to breathe deeply with his mouth open and says, "Oh my God." And Ludlow comes up behind him and asks, "Where's the crew?"
He's trying. The security guard is trying not to puke. Really.
Yeah. Well, he does a better job than what we see Ludlow in the next minute. But as the minute ends, the guard starts to move towards the ship's wheel and replies all over the place. Which, again, makes you raise some questions. But I'll just quickly do this short bit of the shooting script before we get back to that. Last week, we've seen the ship approaching after it crashed through a small vessel. Ian, Ludlow and Sarah and the harbour master all spilled out of the shack to take cover wherever they best they could. And out in the water, you get to see the ship sort of passes a no-wake buoy and drowns it. So that sounds like a little Spielberg thing of the ship doing exactly what the sign says not to. We see it later on when the Tyrannosaur is entering the custom or quarantine area where it smashes its head through a sign saying no animals. But then it cuts through a large yacht that's anchored offshore and cuts it in half and it sinks, which, oops. And it impacts the dock, and the ship cuts into the dock, and as it's sort of slicing it in half, it hits a transformer and knocks all the power out to the harbour area, and the whole area is only lit up by the ship's lights now.
Which doesn't happen in the final movie, actually. You can still see the spotlights are still lit up everywhere.
Yeah, and there's some weird reflections of obviously stage lighting off screen that's sort of illuminating across the water on the side of the ship and that as well when they go to climb up the side of it. But it's implied there that everyone's able to get clear of the ship as well before it crashed, which again, because they had more time after seeing it to get to some hiding places, but heads start to pop up from those hiding places and everyone runs for the ship and starts to climb up onto the deck. The guard pauses and says, "Oh my God, here," and Ludlow asks, what is it and where's the crew? And he replies all over the place where as they move across the deck towards the Tyrannosaur cage, they can see blood all over the place and what might be body parts. So all of that happened on the deck here and not in the bridge, which makes a little bit more sense, especially if the Tyrannosaur is roaming around. But he might have got one or two people, but I'm sure all you have to do is get inside and you'd escape him pretty easy.
Yeah.
But it's also described here, we see the restraints torn and broken, and the girdle used to lift the Tyrannosaur off the ground on the island ripped to shreds. Which, ripped to shreds sort of means more raptors to me than the Tyrannosaur, but...
And I could imagine it was the helicopter, right? You're talking about?
It's the girdle, like the lifting harness.
Oh, girl.
Yeah.
Girl. Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you said the helicopter.
Oh, no.
My bad.
But it's all torn. It's all torn. So you'd think if the Tyrannosaur escaped it, it'd probably bust out of it. Unless it had to chew on it a bit to get through the ropes or through the straps. And it's sort of that, at least that in the script sort of answered the question we had a couple of minutes ago about how the hell did they get the Rex up onto the platform and move it around when it was tranquilized. But
mm-hmm.
But yeah, as we sort of were talking about before, this is sort of all alluding to something other than the Tyrannosaur getting loose and eating people. And maybe, again, that's where the fan theory of that those raptors on the boat come from and somehow grew to a point where a lot of people think that's fact. And then ask, what happened to the raptors that were on the boat? Yeah, I don't know if there's anything else we need to talk about on that.
No, not really.
Yeah. All right, Dave, anything else on 101 you want to talk about before we get heavy for the day?
Yeah, I think we're good.
Alright.
Alright, guys. Let's get the hell out of here.
Contact details are on the website, thelostworldminute.com. You can email feedback to thelostworldminute@gmail.com, Facebook, The Lost World Minute, Twitter, @thelostworldminute, and Instagram, The Lost World Minute.
Easy to remember.
Yeah, very easy to remember. Right. David, thank you for joining me for this recording.
You're welcome.
And we'll be back. I've been Brad.
I'm Dave.
And we'll talk to you all later. Goodbye.
Talk to you later.
Bye.
It is absolutely imperative that we work with the Costa Rican Department of Biological Preserves to establish a set of rules for the preservation and isolation of that island. These creatures require our absence to survive, not our help. And if we could only step aside and trust in nature, life will find a way.